Globally, we are at a crucial point when it comes to climate change. Fires, floods, and record-breaking temperatures have revealed its devastating environmental impact. But what's the cost of climate inaction at a business level? Research by Deloitte says over 80% of executives worldwide are concerned about climate change and how it affects their industries. Yet, many might not be aware of the amount of action required in the next 5 to 10 years in order to address it. Welcome to the Business of Climate Change podcast, brought to you by the Australian Graduate School of Management at the UNSW Business School. In this episode, we're discussing how climate change is impacting business, industry, and global markets. What's our role in addressing this universal challenge? And how can the leaders of today and tomorrow approach the changes required of them? Professor Nick Wailes, Senior Deputy Dean and Director at AGSM, is joined in conversation by Penny Joseph, Head of Resilience and Climate Change Adaptation at Sydney Water. We'll also hear from Kingsley Fong, an Associate Professor at the School of Banking and Finance at UNSW Business School, and an expert on how we can invest for a sustainable future. First up, let's go to Nick Wailes in conversation with Penny Joseph.
Penny, your role is Head of Resilience and Climate Change Adaptation at Sydney Water, which is a long title and a challenging role, I imagine. Great to have you on the podcast. I thought we might start just by talking about how did you end up getting into this role? What does your career look like to get into this role?
So I've had a fairly diverse career. I actually started out my career in the manufacturing industry. So I studied engineering at UNSW. And after that, spent a bit of time in the aerospace industry, both at Boeing and Airbus overseas. And then sort of followed a pathway into the solar industry, did some business improvement roles in Sydney Water, sort of across to sort of some longer term strategy roles, and then landed this role in climate change adaptation. Actually, my background might seem quite diverse, but very, very relevant. Because I've had, you know, quite a lot of operational experience, which was taught me well about, you know, how do you respond to, you know, different events and incidents, and how do you do that, you know, effectively, but also, you know, those opportunities to look towards the longer term strategy as well. So the good thing about my role is that I take both of those parts into account. So I have the longer term climate change adaptation, but also the shorter term emergency management, which sets itself well up for, you know, continuous improvement learning cycles.
And Penny, we're going to talk about the business of climate change in this podcast, and I'm really looking forward to that conversation. I thought I'd start with quite a big topic. You know, so it's very easy when you look at climate change, you know, it seems there's two extremes. There's either it's not happening or there's nothing we can do about it, and there's a sort of pessimism. Where do you sit on that continuum, you know, the sort of, you know, that seems this very polarized debate?
I think change always happens, you know, in the middle. So it doesn't matter what change you're trying to affect. If you're playing at the extremes, it's very, very difficult. So from my role, it's really about, you know, how can we progress forward? And there's so many opportunities for us to progress forward and so many opportunities in that context that it's almost, you know, I suppose irrelevant, you know, some of that situation that's happening in the background, because we've got so many challenges and so many things that we're acting upon.
So do I get a sense from that you're quite optimistic about the future, that you think there's lots that we can do and there's lots of low-hanging fruit that we can address in the, climate change area?
Yeah, so if you look at the different programs of work, look, we have so many opportunities to act on you know, different small and large things. I'm not saying that we should be complacent, because of course we should be acting, you know, with intent. But, you know, we should also be, I think, optimistic about the future. If you're not optimistic about the future, then you may as well pack up now, in my mind. So there's so many opportunities that we have, so much new technology that we can utilise, and so much low-hanging fruit, as you say, as well.
So that's good. I think that's a great place to start our conversation. You know, there are things that we can do and we need to be optimistic about the future. But it is a big challenge, right? And I want to talk a bit later about how your role is structured and how that allows you to do things within Sydney Water. But, you know, one of your key responsibilities is resilient water supply. I wonder if you could just talk us through how the climate change is affecting the resilient water supply and what are some of the issues that we have to deal with in that?
Yeah, sure. So if we look at the last drought, which occurred between mid-2017 and ended in February 2020, it was really one of the worst droughts on history. If we look at why that is, it's not because the dam, the Warragamba Dam, ended up, you know, at a lower point than it had in previous droughts, but more because of the speed that that happened. So we really literally lost 50% of the water supply of the dam capacity, in about 2.5 years. And why that's important is it gives you less time to react or to build infrastructure. But if you take a look at also the events since then, so we had bushfires, then we had a flood. So you had the bushfires in the water catchment, then you have a flood that moves the ash, you know, into the catchment. And, you know, then you have, you know, different events that impact the quality of the water as well. So it's everything from, you know, water conservation to how we can use water more effectively. How do we change customers' habits? You know, we know that people in Sydney, for example, use a lot more water than people in Melbourne. But also thinking about, you know, drought planning, drought response, putting more climate-independent sources of water into the mix, diversifying our sources of water so that if some event happens, it doesn't take out the whole water supply. So it's really, you know, it's a really holistic way of thinking about, you know, a challenge. And because of that, it really does require a lot of people through the organisation who contribute their particular skill sets. It's certainly not just one team or one, you know, small person that is looking into those issues.
That's quite interesting about how these sort of overlapping effects of climate change can really affect the water supply, but also that there's multiple different initiatives that you need, which I think is the sort of strange thing that you know, you as a corporatized entity are often encouraging me to use less water. It seems counterintuitive for a business, but that, you know, that's an important part of the strategy, isn't it, to really emphasise water, you know, effective water usage.
Yeah, it's about effective water usage. So we do also know that, you know, water can play a big part in how the community can adapt to climate change. So thinking about some of the projects that we're looking into, you know, thinking about using water for cooling and greening. So we know that we can, for example, reduce the temperature that people experience by about 4.8 degrees by using water, you know, differently. So it's, you know, it's a very holistic and integrated system that, you know, that you need to sort of think about these issues, because it's certainly not simple and linear, that's for sure.
And then I can remember you saying in something I've been reading that, you know, one of the challenges is water users don't necessarily understand the water cycle and the way the water works. And you know, I wonder how big a challenge that is. And is that true that, you know, some people don't really understand that water goes around and around and there's a finite amount of it?
Yeah, so that's right. So there's really, you know, the same water has been going around and around for, you know, many generations since the dinosaurs. So, you know, it's the same water that is going, you know, through the system and through, you know, people drinking it and peeing it, and it's going, you know, into the rivers and back around as rainfall, and has been for generations. So we find, you know, there's some people obviously that understand that well, and people certainly learn it at school, but I don't think it's something that a lot of people, you know, really spend their life thinking about, unless you work in water, in which case it's all we spend our life thinking about. But what we do know is that people who understand that cycle are very open to, you know, new ways of using water. So thinking about using recycled water for drinking supplies, and there's about 35 cities that are doing that. And then you can think beyond that as well, to ultra pure water, so water that's so purified that it becomes no longer, it's been so cleaned that it's almost too clean for drinking, and is good for other uses like medical uses. but importantly, also for other uses. So things like, you know, hydrogen manufacture. So there's a whole stream of uses. And I think the key message is the more water we have, the more we can put it to different, you know, types of uses. And it's really about thinking about, you know, what are the types of uses that you need, and then what's the best supply to meet those particular needs.
So part of your role is, you know, to pursue this net carbon zero goal that Sydney Water has. So there's things about water that make it pretty high in emissions. You know, can you explain to us why that is?
Well, if you think about water, we actually are moving a lot of water around the system each day. You know, it's millions of, you know, litres of water servicing, you know, 5.5 million people. So if you think about each litre of water, you know, weighs a kilogram, it's actually very heavy. If you've ever, you know, been in a, you know, seen a river flowing, you know, it's quite a powerful thing. So, you know, moving that, you know, volume of water around, of course, you know, takes up a lot of energy. And then there's the treatment of the water as well. So, you know, aspects like you know, desalination and other forms of treatment, which also, I suppose, consume energy, and a lot of that is offset, but the processes themselves, you know, consume energy.
So I think, you know, for me, I never really thought about that. I just assumed I turned off the tap and water came out and it somehow flowed downhill, but there'd been a lot of energy used to get that to me. So that then makes the challenge of net carbon zero, that sort of increases the challenge. So, you know, some of the projects that you're working on, you know, have been described as mining the sewer. Can you talk to us about that and, you know, what's going on there, and how is that generating sort of positive carbon offsets?
So the opportunity we have is really about embracing the circular economy. So it's about understanding that the waste we collect is actually a valuable resource and can be put to good use. So we can use that resource to generate all kinds of valuable, you know, resources. You know, people would be familiar with, you know, biosolids and probably use that, you know, in their gardens. But there's also an opportunity to produce gas, biogas. And currently Sydney Water are partnering with Jemina to, you know, to actually take some of that gas and pass it, you know, to households in Sydney. So I think next year we'll start to provide gas to 6,500 households. So, you know, so there's opportunity for those types of projects, and clearly we can expand those types of projects as well. So we can take, for example, the food waste of the city and also turn that into energy. So they're all the same processes that we utilise to process our wastewater.
Okay, so quite a lot of new revenue streams leveraging the resources that are in the water supply and not letting that go to waste.
Yes.
So Penny, maybe you could talk about the role, how it's structured, and then how you work in the organisation, because I'm really interested in how that structure helps drive things like awareness of climate change.
Yeah, sure. So my role, we know it as being a custodian role. So there's several custodians in the organisation. Climate change is one, but environment, you know, water quality, you know, data, others. And our role as custodians is to actually thread through the organisation. So if you think about topics like the one we were just talking about, the net carbon zero program, you know, there's people that are looking at, you know, innovation and, you know, sequestration. There's people that are, you know, looking at business development. There's people who are trying to modify their operational, you know, efficiency and effectiveness. There are people doing, you know, corporate strategy. There's people in digital services, you know, thinking about digital methodologies. There's obviously people in asset lifecycle who are thinking about, you know, the assets that we need to make and, you know, thinking about how we might do that differently. So there's, you know, lots of people through the whole organisation, you know, having a lot of effort. And my role is to bring those teams together, to succeed together, to innovate together, and to have sort of common purpose. It's a great fun role because what we see now in our organisation is very little, you know, we don't have silos. Like we, you know, if you looked back, the organisation, you know, had a lot of silos, whereas what we're seeing more and more is really effective teams. And so we're achieving a lot and progressing forward a lot. It's a role that I touch a lot of stakeholders and, you know, spend a lot of time joining dots for different people. You know, we have a lot of conversations. We run a lot of forums. And, I enjoy it because I sort of get to go between, you know, strategy and detail. And I often see or think about my role as kind of removing barriers that people have. I think the advantage that I have compared to, you know, other people in the organisation is other people have, of course, conflicting priorities, whereas I've been asked to kind of, you know, take a look at this particular issue and progress that. And so it helps the organisation keep focus on these important issues.
So that sounds great and sounds, you know, a very complex issue like climate change or resilience. It sounds like, you know, it's a mechanism to bring together all of the expertise that you need, but also to get people aligned across their different objectives. But I can imagine that was quite hard to get that to work. You know, when the structure was first put in place and you first put in the role, you know, was it challenging and did you have to change behaviours?
Yeah, for sure. One of the difficulties, I think, was was that really nobody in the organisation in our current structure can achieve by themselves. I absolutely can't achieve my outcomes without utilising other teams, and other teams would say the same thing. And it's been really interesting to go through that experience when we've also all been working remotely with COVID. But wow, it's completely refreshed organisation. You know, we had to spend a lot of time, of course, developing relationships. On a topic like mine, I think it's a little bit easier. The one thing that makes it easy is most people in Sydney Water, the vast majority of people are very caring of this particular issue. They would value the adaptation and the mitigation that we do highly.
Yeah, so and it makes sense to me now that one of the reasons you get into water is that you're interested in the environment, and if you understand the water cycle, you understand these type of things. So I think all of us listening have had to coordinate across complex organisations and get different teams to work together, and you know that's incredibly challenging. What are the key skills that you think you're bringing to that role, and what are the things you really focus on to make sure that you get good progress?
Yeah, so with complex programs, I think a big task is to actually break things down to progress them, and thinking about progressing the complex issues rather than solving for the complex issues, because you can never solve for these complex issues. So one approach to looking at problems is through the Kinnifin framework. So the Kinnifin framework helps you understand what type of problem you're looking at. So it basically describes, four different contexts. The first is like simple contexts. So simple context, you actually need, or it's more effective if you work by yourself, right? Because you can solve the problem and it's easy, you can do that. Then you have technical context. So technical contexts are things that, you know, they might be, you know, difficult and you know, they might have a lot of sort of parts to the problem, but you can actually solve them. So maybe something like a complex or a complicated computer system would be an example of that. Then you talk about complex problems, like wicked problems. There's lots of moving parts. There's more things than you can actually solve for. You'll be working with a lot of unknowns, so unknown technologies, you know, difficult political environments. You'll be thinking about having complexity in your stakeholders. You'll be having, you know, unknowns that you don't know. So you've got all of this changing, you know, circumstances. People often misunderstand the problem is another part of what defines complexity. And then finally, you're talking about chaotic problems. So chaotic problems are much more like an emergency management situation, which I also deal with. And in an emergency management situation, then you are, you know, you're often just trying to bring some kind of structure back to a problem and you need to do it very quickly. So that kind of very direct, very, very specific, almost ordering leadership, you know, works really well in that context because it restores structure to a situation. But in the complex problems, you know, you're really trying to draw on, you know, different skill sets and bring them together, you know, and that's how you can progress the problem.
So I think that's a fantastic summary of that framework. And I think I've been looking at that for about 10 years, but that's much clearer than lots of the ones I've ever heard. But so you really are in that complexity area, right? So you've got unknown technologies, multiple stakeholders, lots of overlapping issues, and you know, you're trying to create a structure that allows people to work through the complexity. Is that the way that you see your role?
So a lot of my role is in that complexity space, but not all of it. As I said, I also have an emergency management in my portfolio, so that's tends to be more in that chaotic space, you know, at the time when you've got an event going on. But I do also have sometimes in the technical space and sometimes in the simple space. So it's really about kind of going, where am I and what's the best approach to deal with this? But in the complex issues, one of the things that I try and draw out is actually the differences of opinion that people have and trying to surface that, because if you can allow that to happen, you can understand problems from, you know, different angles or the different skill sets that people bring. And when you can do that, then, you know, you can come up with new ideas and you can, you know, think about, you know, how you can progress the issues, you know, creating an environment where people can express themselves, raise issues, you know, look at things. Some people will see problems from different angles. It's helpful to be able to do that.
So can you think of a concrete example where you've sort of done that, or, you know, in your portfolio where there's an area where you're having to bring these different perspectives together and resolve that?
Right through my portfolio, actually, but we talked about, you know, some of the challenges with some of the climate risks. You know, how do you do a climate risk assessment? Would seem to be fairly straightforward thing to do, but then what are the plausible futures? Which one of those are you going to adapt to? Which ones, you know, you've got the different types of futures, you don't know which one is going to eventuate. You don't know how people are going to reduce their carbon. So where do you invest, and at what point, you know, is investing too early? Should you invest in everything? Should you invest only in those things that are difficult to change later? You know, do you invest in projects that are already, you know, in flight? You know, do you ask them to go back, or do you allow them to keep moving? So even an issue that's like climate risk assessments, which would appear to be straightforward, in reality, you know, has its own complexities. Now, when you sort of bring the teams together and understand, you know, what they're trying to do, what the different drivers are, you can achieve really pragmatic, you know, ways to do that. And some of the thinking, you know, is, we know that there's going to be a certain amount of change, and so we should build that into our designs at decision points, but that we should also be thinking about designing systems in a way that you can adapt them in the future. So if a particular, you know, scenario turns out to be worse than what we've planned for, that you've planned the infrastructure in a way that you can continue to adapt it later.
Well, so that makes sense to me. So because I'm thinking some of the assets that you're building, so when you're building new infrastructure, they're potentially 100-year life. Is that right?
Yeah, for sure.
And so you sort of need to design them in a way that allows you to adjust for different futures. So that might mean, you know, changing the technologies you use or changing where the water's coming from, those type of things.
Yeah, so the engineering teams absolutely are thinking about those types of answers. And they're trying to design things in a way that opens up options. Some decisions that you make close down options. So in this complex thinking, you're actually trying to make decisions that will open up three more options rather than, you know, making a decision that leads you to dead ends. So they call it, you know, optioneering or you know, trying to make decisions and trying to keep a wide variety of options open as long as you can, so that you've got space to adapt in different, you know, directions as things change.
Penny, I wanted to go back to something you raised a bit earlier, which I thought was really interesting, about the role of water in making cities more livable. And I wondered if you could talk a little bit about that and how we might see water in the future playing a role in our cities and making them livable or mitigating the effects of climate change.
You can understand that if you go under the shade of the tree that you can feel cool. And so that's what you're trying to do in the city, is you're trying to use the water to affect those types of outcomes. So thinking about how you can use the water to, you know, establish more greenery and more blue infrastructure, which is, you know, the waterways. The vision, you know, for the future, it would be really great to, you know, have more of the Parramatta River swimmable, for example. And we know that there's millions of people who live, you know, in 2 kilometres of the water of the Parramatta River. And we've seen that in COVID, right? Some of those open spaces have become much more popular than they ever were before. And so it's really as simple as that. It's, you know, trying to think about all the water infrastructure. Now, new suburbs that can be easier to achieve, in that you can design the suburb around the water as opposed to designing the water around the suburb. And if you can do that and put water at the centre of the way you think about developments, then that can be, you know, really helpful in delivering some of those types of outcomes.
And is that happening? You know, Sydney Water playing an active role in planning suburbs and new developments?
Sure.
But presumably then there's an issue around developers who, you know, trying to optimise the amount of space that they're using and those type of things. So.
Oh, absolutely. These things are collaborations. And so, you know, Sydney Water is part of collaborations with, you know, other government departments, developers, councils. And so everybody has their different take on those things. But even from a developer point of view, these places that people want to live in are worth more money, right? Like, people will pay more to live in a place where they want to live. So I don't necessarily think that those objectives are in conflict. It's really about trying to do it in a way that, you know, people value. And if you're doing that, then you know, you should be able to find a way.
That's good, because I think, you know, we all know that regardless of what we do, the climate's going to get hotter, and then livability is going to become a big challenge. And so, Penny, I thought we might finish off and just get you to think about, what's your advice to us when we're thinking about our businesses and climate change and the role that we can play? What are the types of things that we should be focusing on, and what would you encourage us to do?
I think the biggest thing I'd encourage for people is just to break down the big problems into smaller problems. If you can do that and find you'll be able to see that there's lots of different things you can act upon. And when you do that, you can start to feel positive about the future, and you can see, you know, the positive outcomes that we can each achieve. The second thing I would encourage people to take, or make decisions that open up more options, because that way, you know, you're actually, as you progress forward into circumstances that are unknown, you give yourself more ways to respond in the future. But finally, I think thinking about, you know, leadership instead of management, there's actually a lot of people, certainly in our organisation, I'm not sure in others, that are actually wanting to do the right thing. So we should be trying to lead in a way that empowers people in our organisations, and that's really important and sort of the keys to success, I think.
Great. Well, that's a great summary. Penny, it's been a real pleasure talking to you, and, you know, I think it's easy to be pessimistic about climate change, but, you know, your business, both affected by but able, you know, able to impact the climate, and it's great to hear about the approach that you're taking and some of the fantastic things you're doing. So thanks for sharing your insights, and thanks for joining us.
Thank you very much.
It's clear to most of us that climate change is having a major effect on the things we take for granted, including our water supply. But Penny Joseph's shared insights show it's possible to rise to the challenge and plan for the future. So, we've heard how individuals and teams can take action on climate change within their organisations. But what do these initiatives mean to external stakeholders and potential investors? Associate Professor Kingsley Fong says there are major benefits that come from a strong commitment to sustainability within organisations. As well as being good for the planet, there comes opportunities to attract sustainable investment. Let's go to Associate Professor Fong to find out more.
My name is Kingsley Fong. I'm an associate professor at the School of Banking and Finance, UNSW Business School. The COVID Actually, it has been a test for sustainable investment, and the market has spoken. Billions and billions of dollars continue to flow into sustainable investment vehicles, showing that investor has the resolve to continue the agenda. They see it as important. It's very important to act now because we are basically at the thresholds of some of the environmental and social boundaries of the current global socioeconomic systems. We have exponential growth in populations and resource consumptions, which is not sustainable in the long run. So you will hear about the term ESG, stand for environmental, social, and governance, used interchangeably with the term sustainable investments in the media. But strictly speaking, sustainable investment belong to a broader class of investment approach that's called responsible investment, which include all strategies and practices that incorporate environmental, social, and governance factors into investment decision-making and active ownership. So there are actually three categories you could of responsible investments. There are the basic ones called ESG integration. That's to make sure that analysts and investors use environmental and social and governance information and issues to value financial risk and opportunities. So that should really be practiced by most, if not all, investors. So that's called ESG integrations. And there is an ethical element to it, which is called screening. That's the second type of responsible investment. Screening could be based on your ethical orientations and values. That's the oldest types of sustainable investments, value-based. That's been practiced for hundreds of years. And the last type is called thematic, which is where investors explicitly value environmental and social outcomes as well as financial. And sometimes they prioritize environmental and social outcomes to financial returns. So there are these three broad categories that you, or three levels that you could practice sustainable or responsible investment.
So now we know a little more about how sustainable and responsible investing works. How can we start to integrate these considerations throughout our organisations? We asked the Associate Professor about some long, medium and short-term strategies for companies wanting to attract sustainable investment. Here's what he had to say.
So I say the first thing is to get educated about what responsible investors are looking for. Because there are the criteria under environmental, socials, and governance are probably new to a lot of large and small companies, employees or directors. So it's getting into the specifics is important. And then think about the purpose of the business. I think that's the overarching strategies to deal with sustainability. So how is the business relating to and how is the business serving the world? Think deep along that one. Because there are a lot of resources and inputs and outputs that are not exactly priced. So you need to understand your company well. What are the inputs and outputs that the company or the business is getting and what is it producing? And are this input and output priced by the market? And then you also look at it from a product development and long-term strategy perspectives. So what are the long-term, short-term, medium-term changes that you would expect to the demand of your products? And how you might want to change, for example, your supply chain so you can have products that are more marketable and more sellable in a environment towards higher expectations on company sustainability. And once you have nailed down the purpose of the business and a way to see the future in terms of the products that the company could offer, then you can have the mission statements and the product agendas to recruit talents that would support the missions, right? And that you're more likely to have more conscientious staff and you can attract them. They're not just worried about the financial payoff. They want to buy into the journeys to create values and for a better world. Okay, and for large company, again, at the board levels, are the boards having the right skills and compositions to deal with issues in the climate change, most importantly, and then other social issues? Like there are, for example, recently legislation on modern slavery. These are non-trivial things to deal with. How is the board's composition and the skill sets are able to deal with that? And again, education probably will be necessary on these things. And are there credible incentives in the remunerations system that would indicate the company is taking these things seriously? So again, that's a message and also a mechanism to deliver performance. And it can be just short-term incentives, because long-term, the sustainability issue should help the company to prosper. So that will naturally show up in the long-term financial incentive. But in the short runs, there might be needs for environmental and social performance-based incentives to compensate. So these are many ways that both large and small companies could use to adapt or take advantage of the risk and opportunities that sustainable investments bring.
That's about all we have time for today. Thanks for listening in. We hope you enjoyed our dive into the business of climate change. To find out more about today's episode, search for AGSM's The Business Of podcast online. Please share, rate and review, and subscribe to AGSM's business podcast on your favourite platform and look out for future episodes. In the meantime, you can follow AGSM at UNSW Business School on LinkedIn and Facebook for more industry insights for an accelerating world. Or find us at agsm.edu.au. Until next time, thank you for listening.